But I started out as an author. All I wanted to do was write books. And this one in particular is the third one I wrote, second one I published. But I wrote it with the idea of making money for Make-A-Wish. I just thought of the idea. I don't know if anybody here knows who Bob Gimlin is. He was the Patterson Gimlin film, the old black and white movie. Oh, she does the twist. And okay, you've probably seen that. That's the Patterson Gimlin film. And it's probably the only picture that everybody in the world has seen of Bigfoot. But anyway, Bob became a friend of mine several years ago, about 8 years ago. And we've kept in touch every year at Christmas time. We talk on the phone and calls and Merry Christmas, send cards, that sort of thing. He's really a guy, really sweet guy. He's 86 now, but he was 30-some years old back in 1967. That was with Patterson Gimlin film was shot. But 2014, Christmas Day, I was talking to him, and he works with Wish Kids in his area out in Yakima, Washington. And he gives them sleigh rides in the winter, works with horses and stuff, you know. Children, like, not Make-A-Wish, but it's another wish-granting entity that he works with. But anyway, we were talking about that, and I was joking with him. I said, Bob, has any of those kids ever asked you to find Bigfoot for them? Because everybody knows you as the guy with the, you know, the Bigfoot guy. And he says, no, I haven't. And we chuckled, and then the conversation moved on from there. But after that, the wheels started turning. So early 2015, I started to think, what would it be cool to, you know, write a story like that? And, you know, a little kid wanting to find Bigfoot. So I did publish the book. It took me about 6 months to write it. And the Bigfoot forums that are featured in the film are real. That's a real website. I'm an administrator on there. Have been for years. So they let me use their image on the screen. I talked it over with some of those guys and started writing the book and everything. And I called Make-A-Wish and I said, hey, can I use your guys' name in this story I want to write? In turn, I'm gonna give back to you. Every time I sell a novel, every copy I sell, I'm gonna donate $2 to you guys. And they said, well, that sounds pretty cool. They had a couple prerequisites. One was, I can't say terminal illness, because they want to. Their mission is hope and uplifted spirits. They're not just about making a child smile for a day, it's about actually lifting their spirits up. They like to grant wishes that make that child walk away feeling better. So they said, no mention of a terminal illness, and you can't have anybody die. And I said, well, I think I can work with that. They said, it's really not about her illness, it's about her wish. So I finished penning it late in 2015, and about that time, a gentleman by the name of Cliff Barackman, who's a cast member from the show Finding Bigfoot, joined the Bigfoot forums, and I kind of got acquainted with him that way. And he gave me a picture that he had taken of Bluff Creek, which is the site of the Patterson Gimlin film, on its 48th anniversary, which was October 20th, 2015. He let me use that on the back cover of my book, and invited me out to Ohio to the biggest Bigfoot convention in the world. If you're into Bigfootery, it's where all the field researchers and all the serious gurus go to talk about Bigfoot. So he invited me out there in 2016, by then the book was published, and I was selling copies and donating to Make-A-Wish. So I went out there and met with him, met him face to face, and another guy by the name of Bobcat Goldthwait. I don't know if you guys remember from the Police Academy movies. The guy that can't talk right. In real life, his voice is so soft and mellow. I was like, are you really him? You know, he's bald and has glasses, and he just didn't look like the guy, you know. But it was Bob. That he's a huge Bigfoot nerd too, and he bought a copy of my book as well, and along with Jeff Meldrum and some of the other guys, and of course Bob Gimlin. You know, was I just gave him a copy of the book, and he turned around and wrote me a check for $25 to Make-A-Wish, so that works out pretty good too. But in the meantime, while we were out there talking, they said, you know, this would make a really cool movie. And at the time, Bobcat had just finished his Willow Creek, which was a movie he shot and or produced, and he was there promoting it at the time. And you can get a it on Netflix, and I think, I'm not sure if it was ever in theaters, but I know it, it did make the film circuit. So it's an interesting film if you get a chance to watch it, if you're into the camcorder, lost footage kind of films, you know. But he was one of the encouragers behind making this into a movie. So I come back here and started thinking about turning it into a movie. Some other friends I got to meet in the process had made a movie called Something in the Woods. It was a Bigfoot movie. And I thought, wow, if these guys can do it, why can't I do it, you know? So I just started talking to people. I talked to my wife, who wasn't over enthusiastic at first. But eventually she jumped on the bandwagon, and you know, we you know, gave it a lot of thought and prayed about it, believe it or not, and things just kind of fell into place. We went to the Indiana Fair in that summer. It was late in September, or early September, late. Yeah, it's the first week in September, the Indiana County Fair. But we went there and put a sign-out sheet, and I was just selling the t-shirts and the books and a couple other things that I had. And we got about 50, 60 volunteers, local people that wanted to act. And so then I found a film crew. I hired a director, and he had some students working with him. And so they took care of the cinematics, I guess, and the editing and everything. So it took us, we started October the 15th, we started shooting the playground scene, and we filmed all the way through to June 3rd, we finished the last scene, which was the Bigfoot in the woods and everything. It was very, very long. I won't lie, it was stressful. It was very, very difficult sometimes to get everybody's head together and, you know, how we want to make this happen, what's feasible. You know, had I had a bigger budget, I probably could have done a lot more with special effects, but we did what we could with what we had. But I think it turned out really good. I hired a composer to do the music. So, you know, I'm confident that the music, if anything, the music was, really stands out. Mm-hmm. A local girl wrote the theme song for it. She's only 16, and she wrote the lyrics, and the composer took them and put the melody to it, and they emailed back and forth, you know, Dropbox or whatever they used. And he taught her to sing the song. I took her to a recording studio in Indiana and tracked it and sent it back, and that's how the theme song, the tail end, comes through. But it was an incredible journey. I'm thankful it's over, but I'm also very thankful that I have it, and I can say that I did this. It was definitely a blessing, and I've met a lot of people along the way as well. I became friends with another guy out in Florida by the name of Alan Darnay. I'll talk to you about him. He's got two movies on Lifetime right now that are just currently out. They're currently in rotation, and a third one that he just won a film festival down in Florida for. So I'm making a lot of good contacts. Some really, really great people that I've met throughout the process. So I won't yak anymore. If you guys have any questions, go ahead and ask. Yeah.
Where did you shoot it?
Indiana and Armstrong County primarily. Is you know, most of it. We have a duplex in Tanning I bought, and I've been trying to renovate it for the last year and a half. I'm running out of excuses not to finish it, but we did work on it. That's basically where Sophie lives, you know, when she comes out the front door, and we used the living room in there. It was the hospital room. It was also the back room in the costume shop. We made that nice place. We used it a lot.
Yeah.
Awesome. We put about 8 coats of paint on the wall every time. So the paint's good on the wall anyway.
What kind of budget did you have for the film?
It's listed on IMDb as $25,000. We have probably closer to $30,000 with everything. Half of that was the deal I worked with the director was I bought him his dream camera, basically. And all the fixings that he wanted. I bought a drone, actually two drones.
Yeah.
The first one went in the river right as we were shooting that
scene.
No. So we, needless to say, I ended up buying two drones, but the second one, thank God, it survived everything, and he's still using it as far as I know.
When you approached the director, I guess they basically, that's how they said, this is what I need for making this, is that how?
Yeah. He didn't have, he had about 15 years of experience with short films. You know, I know nothing about pointing a camera. It's a mess if I try it. So if he had experience, and he said, I'd really like to have this camera. And I said, hey, if you're willing to, I'll buy it for you. So it was in a neighborhood of about $13,000-$14,000 with everything. Mm. So,
wow.
Feeding everybody was really the biggest.
Yeah.
The Bigfoot suit was probably the other big ticket. Was because we had we bought a muscle suit. Obviously, I'm not as big as Nikolai was, but
you looked like
it was. It was, well, yeah.
You did look like it.
Couldn't do nothing with my face, but it was a muscle suit. It was, it with the fur. It was the same company that does the Sasquatch, the Jack Lynx commercial Sasquatch suit.
Mm.
It's the same fur.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So it's like it's really cool. It's like a spandex. It's like it never has any wrinkles. Never, So it's stretched over the muscles and everything.
That's
really
awesome.
But it's pricey. So
yeah.
That was another big ticket.
Mm-hmm.
So.
What kind of things did you figure out making this film? What did you learn about the whole filmmaking process that stands out most in your mind?
Everything. I didn't know the first thing other than, I don't even know what button to push on the camera to make it work. But the biggest thing I think I would have to say is, shoot, shoot, and shoot. If you have to have 50 takes, do it. Then sort through them later and pick the best ones. Yeah.
How many shooting days was it spread over that?
I think there was it 25? 25 days? It was, everything was broken down into days.
27 days, but they were 10-hour days.
Some of them were 10 or 12-hour days.
We had a couple all-nighters.
Yeah. Yeah, the wood scene at the end, we finished at like 2:30 in the morning. And believe me, that suit was so hot. I mean, it can be 40 degrees out and you'll be sweating. Everybody else was shivering, putting their hoodies on. I'm like, can we be done so I can unzip this thing? And but yeah, it was a long day most of the time. The longest day we had was 15 hours. And that's when Jason Paul was the boyfriend of Sophie. He is a professional actor. He does go to LA and he goes to, he flies all over the country acting in things. He was kind enough to donate to us, but usually he does get paid. He's from New York, Bradford, yeah. He works in New York, but he's from Bradford. But anyway, he is a professional actor. So he helped, but yeah, he came down and he was only able to come for one day, so we made it a 15-hour day and shot all of his scenes that day.
You had all these kids in your movie. Did you get a big response from the kids and their parents when you had a showing of it?
Yeah, what we did was, one of the blessings early on was a lady named Joan Moore. She's a retired teacher from Lenape School. She had me in, she originally asked me to come speak for Reading Across America Week at the school. And I said, by the way, so you're involved with the school. I said, we're turning my book into a movie. And she said, really? So she was very instrumental. Not only did she get 400 and some letters going home to that elementary school, the children, but she also got the Salvation Army to come that day because there was over 200 people there at the old Katanning Township Elementary School when we shot that scene. Mm. Just the opening sequence with the kids and everything, that was 7 hours, but we had the Salvation Army came and fed everybody.
Can you just talk about what you've done with the film now that it's done? Like, did you screen it in Indiana? Have you done anything house with it.
Yeah, we had the premiere at the Kowalczyk Center in Indiana. It's a 624-seat auditorium, and we had three shows that day. We had 1, 4, and 7, and there was 834 people come out that day between the three shows. It was very well covered. I mean, it was advertised, you know, and we had a lot of people, you know, show up and everything. And I think we would have had more if it wouldn't have snowed. Like, it would have been, I think we would have had over 1,000. I seriously do. Because the 7 o'clock show just didn't have near as many people as the 1 and 4. I mean, it was over half capacity for each of those two shows. So
I gotta ask about, there's this one scene that it just, I'm just like wondering what the logic was to, okay, I'll just ask the question. What is, at least in your mind, what is up with, there's it's in the aftermath of the crashing, there's like this film crew on looking them as they're getting out, and I wasn't sure if that was supposed to be like a news crew, or like what's
the deal?
Yeah,
that was the news crew that Derek had, he wanted them there to capture this girl coming out of the woods, I saw Bigfoot, you know.
Oh.
In his mind, he wanted the publicity, because that was what he was after.
Okay.
You know, he was going to use this child to basically give himself a boost.
Okay.
And so it was kind of, you know, a little bit of humor where they were here, but everything fell apart for you.
Okay. Well, that part, it just passed, went over my head, I guess, that little bit there. But okay, I get you.
Do you have any more plans for the film? Like, other screenings or anything to do with it? Distribution?
I do. It's in several film festivals. I know the director took it to, he put it in several. We just won an award at the I can't think of the name of that town in West Virginia, the CARE, C-A-R-E Awards. You familiar with that? We just won best dramatic feature at that festival. And there are several more that he had entered in, and I headed in Fort Myers Beach Film Festival as well. Alan's trying to talk me into putting it in the Fort Lauderdale International Film Festival, so it could be interesting too. But other than that, my initial plan was to show the movie and benefit Make-A-Wish. That was my goal from the beginning. When I decided, I said, hey, I'm going to be just like the book. I'm going to use this to, and that's what we've done so far, you know. But I understand that film festivals are definitely a part of the process if you want to really get it out there. So, yeah.
Now that we've gone through this whole process, you think you'll do it again? Is there a project on the horizon, or?
Well, I mean, the short answer is yeah. My wife's looking at me with daggers, but. So we'll probably have to negotiate something there, but yeah, I met some people in Texas. They are—they do a lot of Christian films, faith-based films, and my next story has a lot of that in it. So I'd really like to, you know, when the time's right, I'd like to do that. And hopefully, this experience will help. Yeah, Bigfoot and me go back to the 70s, okay, when the $6 million man was on.
That's what I was curious. Like, you know, I mean, I know people that say they saw it. I was so I was just wondering if there was where you were going with.
Yeah, I could tell you an experience I had back in 97 up on Clearfield Mountain. But I was drinking that night, so you can take it for whatever. You know, I had a very strange, I didn't even realize what was going on until I started going to these Bigfoot conferences, and then I found out that, yeah, they throw pebbles at you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can tell the difference between bipedal footprints stomping versus four, you know, like a deer or whatever. And so, yeah, I had to rethink it and say, you know, what was that was following me? but like I said, I was drinking that night. So. But yeah, I mean, I've always been sort of interested in Bigfoot. It's always been something I always wanted to. When I was about 10, I thought, someday I'm just going to bust this open and prove it to everybody what it is. But it's. Well, at least in a cinematic fashion, right?
So when you went and you decided I'm going to make this movie into a film, you just came upon Don Swanson, who was your director. Like, were there any other directors you had to talk to, or was it just, hey, here's a guy, let's do it?
Yeah, at the time, I didn't know that there was a lot of people out there that did this kind of stuff. You know, and he was my son. Well, he teaches at a school my son is at. And I'll tell you, my son is the computer nerd on there, Bogey. That's my oldest son, AJ. So yeah, he loves computers, and he jumped at the chance to take that part as well. But yeah, he's the one that told me about him. And so, but yeah, afterwards I found out that there was a lot of people out there. There are a lot of people that just love doing that stuff.
They did a great job. There's no doubt about the cinematography and speaking as well. I think.
Yeah, and I will say, I mean, every time we play it somewhere, I never know what to expect because I don't own the projector or the sound system. I will tell you, not making any excuses, when you watch the DVD, it's a lot clearer, the night scene especially.
Mm-hmm.
You can see, that's why I jumped to the back. I thought, well, maybe, we were sitting down here, I thought, well, maybe, you know, it's dark from the side and everything, but I got in the middle and it was still kind of dark, so. The cool thing about the suit was the contacts that we had in was they glow when you shine a light on them, like a deer, you know, at night. So it was, I don't know how much of that we could really see on here, but
that was about the only thing we could see was the glowing eyes back there.
Yeah. Yeah, but yeah, the contacts were really cool. It was a great effect.
Thanks much for everything.